Please get my Titanic necklace. Okay. This is from my dinner with Michael. Alig. The dinner was Michael's way of announcing he was back. In addition to the magazine spread, he had just been named as creative director at Meter's arch rival Boris Braun's new club, E. Coli. We were to be escorted by limo after dinner to the club's grand opening with Braun's picking up the tab. When Amanda and Alestra heard I was invited, they begged to accompany me. In Club Craze New York, no matter how macabre the occasion might be, it was still a free evening out. I acted as their entry and they were my temporary armor. Not that I needed protection, but in a crowd like Michael's or Walter's, a little buffering can never hurt. As I looked around the mess of people situated outside of Bowery Bar, it turned out my assumptions were correct. The usual casting call of drag queen to death freaks and trolls were vying for entry to the packed restaurant. Michael had typically over-invited. What was supposed to be a cute dinner for 30 had escalated into a club kid invasion, numbered at over 100 and swelling by the second. Two burly security guards were tripping out and trying to turn everyone away. More than once, I heard one of them mutter under his breath that asshole Michael sure fucked up. We had been waiting almost 20 minutes and had just about given up, resigning ourselves to the dreaded thought of actually having to pay for a meal. Alestra was arguing with one of the doormen when the high, shrill scream of an abnormal queen froze us from behind. It was Michael, and as I turned around and soaked him in, I was met with his pathetic splendor head-on like a car crash. He was smiling like a Cheshire cat and wearing a pair of Power Rangers pajamas with the feet attached and the ass cut out. Silver sequins were plastered over his shaved eyebrows and a demented, clown-like mouth was painted on in bright red lipstick. He clutched a worn-looking stuffed Smurf doll and a small rubber novelty store axe, which he kept hitting people over the head with and laughing hysterically. For the first time since the gossip had started, I wondered if he had really done it. I was broken from my trance by the sound of Michael calling my name. Walter, let Walter and his guests in. Like the parting of the Red Sea, the crowd opened for us and we fairly tumbled into the jam-packed eatery. With Michael pushing from behind us, we were rushed through the front room, past the crowded bar and into the more private back room, which also served as a mini nightclub on the weekends called Bouge. The room was typically overcrowded with the kind of snot-nosed, uptight assholes usually associated with New York's overdone fashion crowd, but tonight was especially creepy. From overrated fashion photographers, diva-in-training junior fashion editors, and wannabe junkie fashion models, the place was crawling with trolls and oozing with an insincerity that seemed almost as dark and vacuous as a black hole. I was in hell. But hey, it was the cool place to be, and I knew what I was getting into when I accepted Michael's invitation. Like a trend-starved stormtrooper, I bit my lip and let him load the girls and I to his table. Lead. The guest list read like a downtown fashion victim and club kid rogues gallery. Every fucking annoyance worth their price in nightlife land was present and accounted for, as well as Michael's little posse of underage, some as young as 12, ravers, tweaked out on crystal, K, and no sleep for days or weeks in some cases. I have heard stories about Michael feeding the kids huge overdoses of Rohypnol and fucking the shit out of them once they blacked out. Lovely. He had recently held a child pornography after-hours party at which the guests used Monopoly money to buy dates with club kids as young as 14. Michael gave the kids free drugs and drink tickets to make sure they went through with it. At the far end of the table sat the undesirable and equally dastardly drag queen contingent of Michael's social circle. Misdemeanor, glory hole, endurance, cliche, fierce ruling diva, and last but not least, Lucretia Elizabeth Gabor. She was particularly fierce because she was responsible for corralling Michael's ever-growing stable of underage boys. She had become one of his closest confidants, and little did he know that, like me, Lucretia would be unable to keep his little secret. Neither of us realized at the time how connected we were. It was ironic, for we absolutely hated each other and rarely had a polite moment. To Walt!
Aren't they, Paul?
Yes, they are.
And on the street yet.
Yeah,